Hi guys, how are you today? My name is Bailey Sarian, and today I just want to sit down, get ready, and then also talk about crime, murder mysteries, stuff like that. I don't know, I feel like it's very... Let me talk about someone getting murdered while I do my makeup. But like, I don't even know how to approach this without sounding insensitive at all. Like many of you out there, I too am obsessed with crime and murder. So crime and makeup, murder, mystery, makeup, Monday. So today I wanted to talk about the Chris Watts case. I was very invested in it. It was sickening. I was up late at night just trying to understand how, why, when, where, everything I could. They released a 2,000 page discovery, and that is put out there. I believe it's put out there mainly for defendants, so they can know what they have against them, I guess. But I think also it's put out there for media, but it's pretty much all the court documents, every single person they interviewed, a whole timeline. That's where I'm getting my information that I'm gonna talk about today. The whole timeline that I have is straight from the discovery. Anything that I use on my face, I'll list in the description box below, but I'm not gonna talk about each product. So let's get ready together. So let's start off with a little background. Shanann Watts met Chris Watts in North Carolina. She was recently divorced when she met Chris, so she was married once before. It wasn't a long marriage, and there wasn't much information about it. So Chris and Shanann dated for 2 years, and then they ended up getting married in 2012. In 2013, they decided to move to Colorado for a job opportunity. And then December of that year, they had their first child, Bella. In January 2015, that's when Chris started working for the company Anadarko Petroleum, and he was a field coordinator. Also in July of that same year, 2015, that's when they had their second baby, Celeste, who they also called Cece. Shanann at the time was working at a children's hospital. She left her job, I'm assuming to be a stay-at-home mom, but that is completely my assumption. And then she decided to work a multi-level marketing company. So she was working for Lavelle. I've never heard of Lavelle. If you know what an MLM is, it's like Mary Kay or Avon, where you buy a bunch of products and then you essentially find clients to buy products from you, and then you get them to join like a pyramid. And apparently she was very good at what she did. She had her own Facebook page where she would go live on Facebook showing new products, new stuff that people could purchase. She was also showing just her life in general on Facebook. A lot of the comments I saw from people in regards to this case, a lot of people were like, she puts her whole life on the internet. Why does she have to do that? Like, why can't she just be in the moment with her family? When you take a step back and you look at the bigger picture, you realize that that's part of the job. Part of the job of the multi-level marketing companies is to get on like Instagram Live or Facebook Live and really promote the products, talk about the products, and get people engaged with you personally. Build a relationship with your clients. Like LuLaRoe, we all had one of those friends who was constantly trying to push that, get you to purchase those damn leggings that nobody wanted. So she was doing that too for these products, and she would show everything. And occasionally Chris would come on the lives as well. And she seemed very successful at what she was doing, and she was pretty high up in the company. But she did end up winning, due to her sales number, a company car, which she ended up getting a Lexus. If you watch some of these lives, and I believe they're still up on Facebook, if not, they're all over YouTube, you can see that Shanann isn't, she's not shy. She doesn't seem shy. Occasionally when Chris would come in, her husband, he seemed more like the shy type or the introvert, not as comfortable as she was on camera. Friends and family would report that their relationship was actually really, really good, and that Chris was the ideal dad. He was always there for the kids. He was taking care of them. He loved them deeply. Neighbors and friends would say that Chris was an introvert. He was very shy and quiet, kept to himself a lot. In May of 2018, Shanann found out that she was pregnant. So Shanann actually went on Facebook Live and recorded Chris Watts' reaction to the positive pregnancy test. So she was sitting on the couch with her two daughters, and she was holding the pregnancy test. Chris walks in and she shows him the pregnancy test, showing that it's positive. Chris's response was strange or kind of weird. If he's introvert and he's shy and he's quiet and he's on Facebook Live, maybe he just doesn't know how to react. With Shanann's work, they got sent on company trips a lot. And in June, her and Chris went to San Diego, and she was on Facebook Live and she was sharing everything about it. It seemed seemed like they got to go a lot of places. They were very well traveled. They decided to have a gender reveal party in August. June 27th is when Shanann and the two daughters went on a 6-week vacation to visit family back at home. They called it a vacation, but it kind of seems like that there was already problems in the relationship. Neighbors would report hearing screaming, fighting. They'd be out on the driveway fighting. And then the next day, Shanann had left to go home for 6 weeks. 6 weeks is a long time. During that time, that's when Chris Watts decided he was going to take advantage of this free time and be a little slut. One of Chris's co-workers, her name is Nicole Kessinger. Nicole and Chris worked together. I'm not sure at what point they officially started talking. I believe there's an email out there. It was like a couple months before the whole affair went down. But due to the police pulling up phone records and computer records, like her web search history, it would make you believe that maybe Nicole was interested in Chris a long time ago. While Shanann was away visiting her family, she did notice a difference in Chris. She felt like he wasn't texting her back. She's pregnant. It's your husband. You expect them to text you, I love you, I miss you, I can't wait to see you, sending you pictures, calling you. Shanann knows something is up. She feels it. She notices something's different. She texts him. She confronts him like, you haven't called me back. What's going on? I haven't heard from you. And this was back in June. So she already had this feeling of like, what's going on? July 7th is the first time on record that Nicole Kessinger called Chris. They held a 2-minute conversation at 12 in the morning. 2 minutes. What the fuck? So that same night when the 2-minute phone call happened, Chris Watts' phone pinged on multiple different routers at different restaurants. July 8th, the next day, Chris texts Shanann back saying, sorry, he fell asleep as soon as he got home from work, that the heat had exhausted him. And he also said that he loved her. And then Shanann writes back asking if he's okay. What's going on? She knows that he's still acting different. And she felt like he did not want to talk to her. Chris replies saying that he's fine and he just is extra stressed out at work. And he feels like he has a lot of pressure going on at work and he's just stressed out. Shanann replies saying that she loved him and missed him and that she wishes her husband just wanted to talk to her. He wasn't, obviously. On July 14th, there is phone records of Chris and Nicole talking to one another. He also had 4 missed calls from Shanann, and Shanann kept continuing to call throughout the day and those went unanswered. There was 1-minute phone call between Chris and Shanann later in the day, but the rest had went unanswered. Little shady little bitch. Because he was out with Nicole at a car museum. There is records of Shanann talking to her girlfriends, saying that she notices something's different with Chris. She feels like the relationship is just kind of distant. He doesn't want her as much as he used to. He used to be very like hands-on, lovey-dovey, all over her. That was on July 14th. I don't know if I said 17th. July 14th. So that same day, Chris told Shanann that he no longer wanted to be together and that he did not want the baby. Shanann obviously did not want to do this. She didn't want to separate, so she suggested marriage counseling. Chris turned down. He did not want to do it. He just wanted out. On July 18th, Nicole Kessinger and Chris Watts share a bunch of nude photos to one another via text. And Chris created a secret folder on his phone. It was like a calculator app, but really you type in a code and it is a photo album. So he was transferring all these photos to that photo album. Also, it was reported on his computer search engine that he was Googling vacation spots. I guess he was planning on going somewhere. On July 24th, Nicole, little Nicole, the mistress, it was shown on her computer that she had Googled, man I'm having an affair with says he will leave his wife. So she obviously knew at this time because she's typing in, man I'm having an affair with will leave his wife. So she knows, you know, is married. Come on, she knows. So on July 24th, Shanann is still texting Chris asking what's going on, telling him how she feels, just everything that's been built up. I feel like she had that gut feeling that something was going on and she was just trying to get to the bottom of it. It was reported on Chris's computer that on July 25th, Chris had searched when to say I love you and when to say I love you in a new relationship. Also, what do you feel when somebody tells you they love you? A lot of news reports were kind of stuck on this one. This is just weird to be Googling, when do you say I love you? And how do you not know what love feels like? You're married, you should know. It seems like he just doesn't, I don't know. He just has like a disconnect happening, right? He's a strange little man. On July 28th, Chris and Nicole go on a vacation to the sand dune and they stay the night. There are multiple pictures of this. He transfers them to his secret calculator app. On July 31st, that's when Chris flies to North Carolina because he's now going to pick up Shanann and the kids. Well, he's gonna go see them, meet up with them, and then fly back home. Second through the third, it's reported that Chris is constantly transferring images to his secret calculator app. He's talking to Nicole while he's out in North Carolina. The family had reported that he seemed quiet, extra quiet, and also very distant. On August 4th, Nicole's search history said that she was Googling wedding dresses because she just wanted to look at them, I guess. Also, had Google searched Chris Watts for his like Facebook page, and she also searched for Shanann's Facebook page. On August 7th, Shanann had texted her friend saying that Chris is terrified of this new baby, that he really doesn't want the baby, that he's just happy with Bella and Celeste and he doesn't want another baby. Obviously, this is heartbreaking for Shanann. He told her that he wanted another child months back and now he's saying that he doesn't want it. She's already pregnant. What is she supposed to do? So she's obviously very stressed, very emotional, texting her friend, trying to get advice. Her friend says he's probably just scared and not to stress on it too much because he's scared. Another baby, more responsibility. On August 8th is her 15-week appointment for an ultrasound. Also when she cancels the gender reveal party. So she had a friend reach out asking why she canceled the gender reveal party and she responded, Shanann said her and Chris are not compatible anymore. He refuses to hug her. He pretty much has no interest in her and he does not want to go to counseling either. Just tells her he's not interested anymore. On that same day, Nicole over here was Googling, wait for this, marrying your mistress. So Nicole is Googling marrying your mistress. She's sloppy. Why are you Googling that? Just guess how that works out. Probably doesn't work out. Shanann did find out that she's having a boy, which she was gonna announce at the gender reveal party, and she decides that she was gonna name him Nico. So Shanann also was texting friends saying that she doesn't want to be a single mom, that she can't afford to be a single mom, that she really wants to go to counseling with Chris. She really wants to make it work. She then on Amazon looks for couples counseling books and she purchases one asking if Chris, if he would read it. He says he will, so she purchases it in hopes to fix the marriage. I mean, she's obviously taking these steps. She's really trying to make the marriage work. On August 9th, Shanann and her friend slash coworker, her name is also Nicole, the good Nicole, Shanann's friend, fly out to Arizona for a work conference. It was said from Shanann's friends that Shanann was really down. She wasn't feeling well. She was really just not herself at all. Shanann also wrote Chris a really long letter. Her one last attempt to really save the marriage. She's explaining how she felt. They wanted another kid and just, it was one last attempt. August 9th, it was also reported. This was a weird thing that a lot of people got hung up on. Chris sends Shanann a really strange photo. It was reported that it was one of their daughters underneath what seems to be a blanket or a bag. It's not really clear what exactly it is. By the looks of it, it almost doesn't even look like one of the daughters. It looks like Barbie legs. Like it looks like fake legs. Like it was a doll. But Chris sends this to Shanann. Now, knowing what we know now, a lot of people were like, is this Chris giving a warning? Was he trying to tell Shanann what was coming? I mean, nobody knows. Nobody knows what the hell that was. She posted it on her Facebook and comment was something along the lines of, I don't know what to think about this. And I mean, nobody really does. It's just a really strange photo and there was no context to it. So is it a warning sign? I don't know. On August 10th, Chris asked his neighbor if their daughter could watch the girls while he went out to a baseball game. He wasn't going to a baseball game and Chris ended up going out that night with Nicole. In the discovery as well, on August 11th, it's reported that Nicole, the bad Nicole, her Google history is hella messy and she was Googling how to prepare for anal sex. She was looking up threesomes, oh my God, and she was looking at porn. And it was reported that she was looking at porn a lot on her computer. I don't really feel like who cares? I guess I didn't have to like mention this part, but there were a lot of reports about it and people were also like, oh my God, she was looking up anal sex. But it's like, if that's what she's into, leave her alone. Like she's allowed to be into that. But she was looking to prepare for back entry. So August 13th comes, Nicole, the good Nicole, Shanann's friend, and Shanann head home. Their flight gets delayed, super frustrating. She's pregnant, she's not feeling well, she just wants to go home. They didn't end up getting home until almost 2 a.m. Nicole drops Shanann off at home at 1:48 in the morning. And this is when we don't really know what fully happened in this time frame. 5:30 a.m. comes around. It's caught on security footage from the neighbor, Chris Watts, pulling his truck up to their garage. It was reported by many people that Chris left his work truck on the street only because Shanann didn't like it when the work truck was on the driveway because it leaked oil and then it would just ruin the driveway. So Chris never really put the work truck on the driveway. Neighbor's security footage caught Chris reversing up into the garage. And then Chris is loading things into his car and he makes three trips. There isn't a clear shot of what Chris is putting into the car. It looks like bags. Like it's really grainy and it's hard to see, but you do see him making three trips. Like, so at 8:30 a.m. that same day, Chris calls the school where Celeste and Bella attend. He tells them that the children will no longer be attending the school. He didn't just say they were going to be absent. He said that they were no longer going to be attending. That same morning, Nicole, the good Nicole, Shanann's friend, she texts Shanann. Nicole knew that Shanann hadn't been feeling well, but she also knew that Shanann had a doctor's appointment that same day, like in the morning. But she was just checking in with her, see how she was doing, see how she was feeling, how did the doctor's appointment go? You know, she's just being a good friend. So when Nicole didn't get any answer from Shanann, she just felt like that was really unlike her. Nicole, she and her son drive over to Shanann and Chris's house. She knocks on the door, she's not getting a response. She tries to open the front door. They have one of those front door cameras. If something triggers the camera, it gets sent to your phone and you get like an alarm saying someone's at the front door. So that gets sent to Chris's phone. Nicole texts Chris saying that she's at their house. She's really worried. She hasn't heard from Shanann. What's going on? And Chris tells Nicole that Shanann had mentioned she was going on a play date. That's all he knew. So Nicole looks into their garage and she sees that their Lexus is there with the two car seats in the car as well. That's their only car. So Nicole knew like there's no way she went on a play date. She left the car and the car seats. There's just no way that she would take the kids without their car seats. So then Nicole goes back to the front door and she tries to go inside and she notices that the door is locked from the inside, so nobody could have left through the front door. When Nicole tried to open the door, it set off an alarm again to Chris's phone, and Chris calls Nicole and tells her that she needs to leave the property, that Shanann is on a play date. Stop trying to break into my house, pretty much, is what he's saying. Nicole tells Chris, like, I'm gonna call the police. And Chris says, no, don't call the cops. Do not get them involved. Nicole calls the doctor's office and finds out that Shanann did not show up to her appointment. And then Nicole then calls the police to do a wellness check. Nicole tells Chris that she had called the police and Chris says that he's on his way home. A welfare check, not a wellness check. Sorry. Police show up and they cannot get into the house without Chris's approval. So the police officer speaks to Chris on the phone and asks for the garage passcode because he could get through the garage with the passcode, and then also ask Chris for permission to go inside the house and look around. Chris says passcode doesn't work. So finally Chris arrives, and different clips of him walking up to the house, and he's just kind of like walking all slow-mo. Someone was that worried and there was like a police officer at your house, wouldn't you kind of move with urgency? Well, Chris was walking just kind of like slow. So police do a search of the home. They noted that nothing looked out of the ordinary. The only thing that was weird was Shanann's belongings were inside the home still. Nicole had said that Shanann had a bit of OCD, so she was always cleaning. Everything was organized. Everything had a place. Her house was never messy. I believe Nicole is the one who found Shanann's cell phone, which was in between the cushioned seats in the couch. And Nicole said that Shanann would never leave the house without her phone. There's just no way. Also, another thing that was missing were the bed sheets from the girls' bedroom and the master bedroom. So everything else was there except for the bed sheets. Chris had spoken to the police and said that when Shanann got home, they had a discussion about their marriage and they also got into a fight. And then he woke up at 5 a.m. and then he left for work. So that's when local news came and did an interview of what was going on, and they interviewed Chris. Now, Shanann's mom told Chris not to do the on TV like interview. She didn't want him to because she didn't think he was guilty. Normally, if you do those interviews, people will always point the finger and say you're guilty. And later on, Shanann's mom said, thank God that he did that interview, because if you watch it, Chris is a terrible actor. In the interview, they're asking, do you know where your wife is at? And Chris is saying, no, I don't know where my wife is at. I just want them to come home. And he's like, has this little snicker and he's kind of laughing. And the whole thing is just weird. If your wife and two children are missing, you're probably not going to laugh. I don't think you see him cry or shed a tear once. It's the strangest thing. On August 13th, it is reported on Chris's phone that he is going through and trying to delete text messages. He's also trying to delete anything that has to do with Nicole and get rid of any evidence. Nicole and Chris, the bad Nicole, hold a 51-minute conversation on the phone. She states that she had no idea that his wife and children were missing. She had no clue what was going on. We don't know what they talked about for 51 minutes, but suspicious. Then it's reported on Nicole, the bad Nicole, on her Google that she was looking up Shanann Watts. So this was August 14th. She was Googling Shanann. On August 14th, the bad Nicole, she also Googles, can cops trace deleted text messages? She spent a good amount of time Googling how to get rid of text messages, which, again, weird. I don't know how she didn't get in trouble for tampering with evidence, but what do I know? I really don't know anything. Of course, when the FBI interview Chris, he denies having an affair and says, quote, nah, I wouldn't do that. End quote. He also says it is possible that Shanann may have been having an affair. Chris also explains that they fell out of love with one another and that the relationship was not going well. The FBI informed Chris that he is a suspect and asked him if he would do a polygraph test, which he does indeed do. One of Chris's co-workers, he had found emails between Chris and Nicole and wanted to turn them in for evidence. Coincidentally, at that same time, the bad Nicole decided to come forward to police and tell what was going on from her side. Also, the same guy who turned in the emails, he turned in Chris's GPS that was in his truck. And then Chris does a polygraph test and Chris fails miserably. He just fails. So we have the FBI sitting down with Chris, pushing him to confess. Chris keeps saying he doesn't know, he doesn't know. They look up the GPS that was in Chris's truck and they see where Chris went. Authorities do a drone shot. So they get a drone shot of the workspace and they spot the bed sheets that were missing from the home. I mean, you put two and two together. Chris's work site, these are the bed sheets. They also notice fresh movement in the dirt, like something had been buried. Meanwhile, they're still interrogating Chris and trying to get him to confess, and he will not budge. So then Chris requests to talk to his father. So his father was there. Father asks, did you hurt them? Did you have anything to do with it? And Chris says yes. Tells his father that he saw Shanann hurt the kids. FBI agents come back in and Chris's father stays in there as well. Chris confesses. So he says that Shanann had come home. They started to talk about the separation. Chris then left the room and then he went into Bella's room and he saw on the baby monitor that Shanann was strangling both of the kids. And then Chris says that he blacked out in rage and strangled Shanann. So then he says he loaded them into the truck, which was caught on camera, and he drove them to his workplace where he then dumped the bodies. So he buried Shanann in a shallow grave. He dumped both of his daughters into the big oil tanks. It was said that the oil tanks, it was an 8-inch hole and that he had to shove one of the girls in there because they weren't fitting. And there's actually some hair found on the oil tanks that like ripped out. Both of the girls were in these big oil tanks. Still, you're not really seeing Chris show any type of emotion. I mean, he's talking about dropping his babies into these big oil tanks. Yeah, you just like can't wrap your head around it. It's just weird to watch and uncomfortable. They were sent off to the coroner's office where they determined that the two daughters were smothered. So they weren't strangled, they were smothered. Reported that Shanann was strangled. Chris's defense was that Shanann was strangling the kids first and then he killed back in rage. He's a narcissistic asshole and he had to blame somebody else. That's what narcissists do. After the murder, the bad Nicole, Google history shows that she was searching Amber Fry. She also searched Amber Fry book deal, also Amber Fry net worth. And lastly, did people hate Amber Fry? If you don't know who Amber Fry is, she was the mistress of Scott Peterson, where he murdered his pregnant wife. And Amber Fry was the mistress. The bad Nicole was trying to see if she can make some money off of this. So Chris Watts ended up pleading guilty on November 6th. To multiple counts of first degree murder. He was found guilty and was sentenced to 5 life sentences. In the discovery, it kind of talks about how Chris has been acting. He was on a suicide watch. They thought that he was gonna try and kill himself. Still, not much emotion was reported. He ended up getting moved to a different maximum security prison because there were a lot of security concerns. So he's in prison for life. He didn't get the death penalty and he's going to live a very awful life in prison as he deserves. But sadly, you know, Shanann Watts, Bella and Celeste lost their lives. There was one interview with an FBI agent, Brad Garrett, and he reported that people responsible for killing their families are always white males in their 30s. And most of these crimes occur in August before school starts. They said that the Chris Watts case was unusual because usually when a man kills their whole family, it usually ends in suicide where they kill themselves. So it was a rare occurrence. But please be careful out there around August if you are with a white male in his 30s. If you would like to see more videos where I talk about crime, let me know down below. Other than that, I hope you have a good day today. Be careful out there and I'll see you guys later. Bye.